people have come from the most remote parts of Kerry. And they've come to Dublin representing Kerry, wearing the Crayons green and gold jersey, and they've achieved national iconic status. These are Kerry men. These men can come to Dublin. They can take on the best in the country at Gaelic football, and they can win. And they do that because we are Kerry.
The green and gold, try and explain it, you can't. It's almost intangible what it means to put on that jersey. It's your mother, your father, it's your grandfather, it's the Irish, as they say in Irish.
We played upon boggy hillsides against that gale from the north and west, for we cherished but one ambition: to prove that Kerry was best.
The GAA was founded in the winter of 1884. But football and hurling had been played throughout Kerry for centuries. The old-time football game was called Cadge. It was parish-to-parish football with an unlimited number of players participating.
It was much, much closer to rugby than to the what we call Gaelic football now, a game that did not exist in the olden times. So it's understandable how rugby had got a grip in all the towns and areas of Kerry before Gaelic football came. And every town had a rugby club. And the champion rugby club in Kerry was the Killorglan Rugby Club.
The Killorglan rugby team was captained by J.P. O'Sullivan. He was a famous athlete and was affectionately known as the champion. In 1888, three graduates of St. Patrick's College, Dublin, were recruited to teach in the Killorglan area. Tom Cronin, Jack Murphy and Dennis Downing had been playing members of the Aaron's Hope Club in Dublin and had acquired all the rules and skills of the new game. They persuaded J.P. O'Sullivan to switch from rugby to the new game of Gaelic football. This marked the formation of the Lawn Rangers Football Club and the arrival of Gaelic football in Kerry.
The team that first played for Kerry in an All-Ireland final, it was the Lawn Rangers, the new name for this club in Killorglan. They played against Dublin in the All-Ireland final of 1892, which Dublin won. And you could say that the Kerry-Dublin rivalry, as it is known today, that was the first step in it. And JP was the inspiration of that team. He was the spokesman, he was the captain, he was the leading player.
Kerry's first All-Ireland football victory came in 1903. The team of 17 was drawn mainly from Dr. Croke's club in Killarney and John Mitchell's club in Tralee. It took three games to decide the outcome against Kildare.
Kerry's would-be winning goal the first day was played behind a line of spectators down the wing before it came back in to be scored. That caused an objection, of course, which led to a replay. And the GAA discovered the joy of the replay.
And it is said that 30,000 people attended that game, and that was the biggest crowd that ever attended any sporting event in Ireland up to then.
Pages of newspaper space were given over to the games for the first time. Colour writers arrived at the match who'd never seen Gaelic football to describe the scenes.
And then it went to a second replay, played down in Cork, and Kerry won that. They added a second one then, following year, 1904 final, played in 1906. That was the first double recorded by Kerry.
Then in 1913, a revolution. The team size is reduced from 17 to 15. Suddenly, the removal of just four players off the field creates another acre of space. The first match under 15 aside is Kerry against Louth. People were talking about it in the 50s as the greatest game ever played. The reason is that it was so new, and this notion that you could jump in the air, catch a ball, kick it into space, a player would run after it, all the things that make the heart dance about Gaelic football nowadays, where they were seen for the first time. Dick Fitzgerald became a household name.
Dick Fitzgerald, I suppose, in a way, could be deemed the first superstar in Gaelic football. He was there when they won the first. But then, 1913, he was the Kerry captain when they won the All-Ireland. He repeated it in 1914. He was captain again. So he was one of the first people to hold 5 All-Ireland medals. And he was such a big figure that he wrote the first book ever on Gaelic football. How to Play Gaelic Football by Dick Fitzgerald. Came out in September 1914.
It gives a very clear template, which every team in the country followed for 60, 70 years, where your team is laid out with the strength of each player accentuated by the position you put them on the field, and players mark each other. And that man-marking factor, I mean, other sports had it, other team sports had it, and have, you know, discarded it in many ways. That man-marking factor was central to how Gaelic football was played.
When the Irish Volunteers were formed in Kerry in 1913, former Kerry football captain Austin Stack was appointed leader. During the War of Independence, Stack became Minister for Home Affairs in the Doyle Cabinet and IRA Deputy Chief of Staff. After the signing of the Anglo-Irish Treaty, he seconded De Valera's motion calling on the Doyle to reject that agreement. A clear majority accepted the treaty, but the bulk of Kerry Republicans revered Stack and followed him during the ensuing Civil War. The worst atrocities of the conflict were committed in Kerry. Kerry footballers took opposing sides in the bitter civil war. John Joe Sheehy was a leader in the IRA, while Con Brosnan was a captain in the Free State Army. Activities on Kerry's playing fields were at a standstill. Hundreds of Republicans were interned in the Curragh.
The time came when these young men inside in the Curragh practiced football day and night. And suddenly in the middle of the 20s came the great release. As Padraig O'Donnell says, the gates flew open.
And they challenged the Kerry team that had won the Munster Championship. And it drew a huge crowd for a challenge game.
We all came into Tralee expecting civil war between the two sides that had fought so bitterly against one another in the civil war. And it was a beautiful match.
Tim O'Donnell told me in later years how bad it must have been inside in the dressing room when, as he said himself, if you lit a match, the thing would explode, the dressing room would explode. But in actual fact, they were coming together closer and closer together.
It ended in a draw. And I think it's the only challenge game that was ever replayed. And it was replayed, drew an even bigger crowd for the replay, and the ex-internees won it. With the result that the team that went out to play in the All-Ireland semi-final, I think there were 11 new players on it.
Con Brosnan was the peacemaker in Kerry football. It is hard to imagine that Con Brosnan and John Joe Sheehy could eventually travel to matches together in the same car, be involved in the same selection committee for the Kerry senior team, and give their lives to the game, really.
Now, that new team then went on to be one of the greatest teams Kerry ever had. They won the All-Ireland of 24. Quite a few of them, and most of them, were there when they won in 26 again, and there were survivors into the four-in-a-row team from 29 to 32. And that was a wonderful era for Kerry football. As well as winning, it brought all sides together for the common cause of Kerry football.
There are a lot of counties in Ireland where people would say that, you know, a strong team actually did damage to the long-term interests of Kerry football. What Kerry did is quite the opposite. They seem to have been able to send out a very strong team, 1903, 1904, run up a string of All-Irelands by 1914, come back in the 20s and do it again, then win the four in a row. And the four in a row was a huge achievement, second team to do it after Wexford. And they almost had 5. They lost it with a pretty bizarre last minute goal in the semi-final against Cavan in 1933.
Here in Tralee, the man of the hour is the one and only John Joe Sheehy, who has just been elected to the Hall of Fame.
Well, this is the most beautiful collection of trophies you have here.
Well, they are splendid, Jerome, there's no doubt about it. I'm certainly very proud of them. They are a splendid collection and they help one considerably in travelling along Bohari in this winter maradetter.
What game stands out in your memory?
Jerem, every game stands out well. They all have their own particular memories. For one, perhaps the 1924 All-Ireland, which was our first and which was Kerry's first after 10 years in the wilderness, was a game that should be remembered. You might remember that we played and beat Dublin on that day with the famous O'Toole's, a wonderful club they were too.
Kerry were very fortunate in the mid-20s when Dr. Eamon O'Sullivan came on the scene. He was a son of the champion, or JPs, so he would have a good sporting pedigree. He was a very good sportsman in his own right. Gaelic football, rugby and athletics.
I think he has been kind of airbrushed a bit out of the GAA history. With the exception of his club, Dr. Crokes, I'd say everybody else has probably forgotten about him.
They talk about Sean Boylan of Meath having a long reign. But he lasted with maybe 1 or 2 years out here and there. Until the 60s.
And when I tell people that he trained winning teams in 24, 26, 37, 46, 53, 55, 59, 62, 8 All-Ireland winning teams, and he only trained one losing team, that was in 1964.
He was the principal medical officer of St Finian's Mental Hospital here in Killarney.
He was the man responsible for the building of Fitzgerald Stadium. And when the Fitzgerald Stadium was built and it opened in 1936, he used that as occupational therapy for the patients. He used to bring the patients out of the hospital where they were locked up in the wards, and he'd have them digging and moving and laying sods and stuff like that.
He was a very quietly spoken man, very distinguished, tall, beautifully dressed.
He never had football boots on him or tracksuits. There was none of them in those days. He'd have his little whistle, and he had the most unusual way of training the teams.
He did things like he weighed us when we arrived, which we couldn't see much sense of that then, and had a stopwatch. They were unusual accoutrements in a GAA training camp.
He wrote a book about Gaelic football as well. The art and science of Gaelic football. Modern day practitioners would not agree with a lot of it.
His biggest philosophy was each player should play in their own position.
He had a theory that you should maintain your sector at all costs.
So obviously there was a goalkeeper. His sector was delineated by the square and the goalposts. He had the fullbacks, the halfbacks, the midfielders, half forwards and forwards in little squares. He got you to see that that ball should be controlled and delivered in a directional way, almost at a set trajectory that suited the forwards.
And every time you got the ball, you were to drive it as far and as high as you possibly could. And the guy where it was landing then should be able to win it in the sector where it was landing. I suppose it was a great system if you had 15 footballers who would be 15 real good fielders.
The influence of skill diminishes when there's bunching or crowding. And that was his principal reason why for insisting that players kept their positions. And they usually did during his reign.
He's been accused and people have said it was too orthodox, but what is really interesting is that even in the 40s and in the late 30s, teams were trying alternatives to the Eamon O'Sullivan approach, and he always seemed to win out in the end. You know, the very fast hand-passing Antrim team of the 40s is supposed to have revolutionised Gaelic football, but it was Kerry that won the All-Irelands. Roscommon, you know, came up and stole a couple of All-Irelands. Kerry came back with what may have been regarded as orthodox, what may have been regarded as rigid, but they were back and winning more and more and more All-Irelands with it.
Well, the Kerry of my youth was the hungry 40s, really, and into the early 50s, which were poor times in Ireland, there's no doubt about it. When I was about 10 or 11 or 12, to get a football, you'd have to collect for it. We went around the town collecting for a football. Give us something for a football, sir. And we'd pick a fair day, which when the fairs were on the streets, and you'd have a much better chance of getting monies from the farmers in selling their stock. We would wait eagerly, calling every day to the hardware merchant. Did the football come yet from Birmingham, I think it was? And eventually it would come and we would get our day in the sun.
Kerry is a huge county, remember, and huge variations in geography and topography and everything else. And, you know, people have come from the most remote parts of Kerry, and they've come to Dublin representing Kerry, wearing the Crayons green and gold jersey, and they've achieved national iconic status. And I think that's what Kerry people appreciate, that over the years, over the bad, bleak, barren years of the first half of the last century, that they came forth with outstanding footballers and proved themselves on the national stage and brought identity to Kerry. They brought an identity to Kerry that transcended sport. You know, these are Kerry men, these men can come to Dublin, they can take on the best in the country at Gaelic football and they can win. And they do that because we are Kerry. Most people outside of Kerry viewed Kerry as different. Kerry were the people who basically dictated the pace of Gaelic football. They set the standards, and now and again others might match them, but normally they wouldn't match them.
An arm ball in towards the goal. Jimmy Dean has gone back for it, and Jimmy Stevens out again to Tim Kennelly, who's having such a blinder. Listen back to Egan, and now they're really rolling. Egan across to the far side of the field. Mikey Sheehy, in it goes now, and a goal! Jack O'Shea has scored!
Well, in all eras of Kerry football, you had big names, iconic figures. Dick Fitzgerald and Austin Stack in those early years. And then in the 20s and leading into the early 30s, people like Con Brosnan and Bob Stack and John Joe Sheehy and the Landers and these. And then you came up to the next era when you took the likes of the great midfielder Paddy Kennedy and Eddie Walsh, the defender, and Joe Cahan and Gege O'Connor, any amount of them. And then that moved on and you came into the 50s. And without any doubt, the greatest figure to appear, not alone in Kerry, but a national figure in the sport of Gaelic football, had to be Mick O'Connell of Valentia Island, who played Kerry Minor in 1955 and then went on to become a Kerry Senior in 56. And he was still there on the field for the Munster final, came on as a sub in 1974.
People of today wouldn't be able to appreciate the mythical atmosphere that surrounded Mick O'Connell, the Kerry football. Everything he did, you know, was special. He did unusual things. He was an extremely modest, shy man, a fantastically talented footballer. But, you know, he set a standard for the whole mythology of Kerry football for a whole generation, Mick O'Connell.
My uncle used to come on holidays to Dingle, and from a very early age, he was talking about this young fella that was over in Valentia. And that he was kicking ball, that he was different to anybody.
Keep your eye on the ball. Liam, get down now and try and block him. Get down fast.
He had a lovely way of soaring up into the air and getting the ball. He was a very stylish kicker of the ball, but he was also a very purposeful kicker of the ball. He was able to kick equally well from the ground or from the hand. And above anything else, he was a believer that the rules of the game should always be honoured and respected by players.
I asked him in an interview fairly recently, did you play against so-and-so? And he said, I never played against anybody. They were merely the opposition, he said.
Mick O'Connell and other players weren't always allowed to play the way they wanted to play, but that's part of football as well. But still, wherever Mick went, people wanted to see him.
the crowd came out in the middle of the field and gathered in a circle around him as he sat down at the half-time break. And if he moved, they moved. And the whole concourse were just amazed and in awe of this islander, this strange man from the wilds of Kerry.
I mean, of all the skills of him, he had it. And, you know, he could catch a ball immaculately, he could deliver a foot pass, he had the sense of reading the game. But he is the, you know, the great ornament of Gaelic football. I think we should all be lighting candles to him.
Dermot, who's the greatest Kerry footballer ever?
Maurice Fitzgerald. And Dennis Burkhardt.
And what about Mick O'Connell?
Mick O'Connell.
Hello everybody, and welcome to Croke Park for the playing of the All-Ireland Senior Football Final of 1960 between the Munster champions Kerry and the Ulster champions Down. And a huge crowd gathered to see the answering of the big problem: can Down win their first All-Ireland, or is the kingdom going to win another?
Their first major setback came when Down arrived in 1959, 60 and 61 and beat Kerry in the final and a semi-final.
The crowds went to figures which are well beyond what any safety officer in the whole of his health should have tolerated in Croke Park at the time. They went into 90,000, and everybody wanted to see, you know, Kerry the traditionalists against Down, you know, trying something new.
Part of our strategy actually was to keep the play out of midfield and to move the ball around midfield through the half-backs. And this is where I think the weakness of the zoning theory of Dr. Eamon came against them, because it took Kerry a while. I mean, I think Micko was wondering why the ball was going over his head.
That was a wonderful location for football, not for Kerry people, not for the Kerry players that were on duty. But was, if you like, a very, very important milestone in the history of the GAA. The Down beat Kerry.
They were very skillful and they were very dedicated, and they had a belief in themselves.
They generally played a game, a possession game, and they worked out different tactics. They played players in front of players and block players and all that type of stuff. Something like the Northern teams are playing at the present time. But they definitely changed the game as it was up to then. It was a real catch and kick game up until they arrived.
Mick O'Connell with it now on the halfway line.
In 1968 as well, they beat us in an All-Ireland final, and John Lennon made a big statement that after that final, he reckoned that Kerry were about 20 years behind him, and that wouldn't be seen for years and years to come.
And I mean, that really put the cat among the pigeons for anybody to suggest that Kerry football was 20 years behind the time. And I think he was proven to be largely right, because they had to hurry up.
We savour Kerry victories, we salute a gallant foe, and when we lose, there's no excuse, we pack our bags and go. And that's what we did, I think, that time. We took our beating.
Kerry have taught an awful lot of teams how to win. People forget they also taught us how to lose, and how to lose with dignity and grace. Kerry had that great self-confidence in themselves. They would never admit to be beaten by a worse team.
The game was on.
When Galway came around, they also managed to beat them, win three in a row and make life difficult for Kerry. But Kerry's tradition and Kerry's this flowing river of, you know, football innovation, it doesn't really matter who wins this year, because next year we're going to be back in the All-Ireland final. There was this level that they'd reached which nobody else would ever challenge, and to some extent never have, that it's their divine right to be in Croke Park on the third Sunday in September, the fourth as it used to be in the old days.
I remember the ritual myself, within myself, when I put it on for the first time. I felt it was a jersey of invincibility. I felt there was no way I could not perform.
Billy Morgan, Cork goalkeeper, placing it for the kick out.
A meeting of Cork Kerry is a very, very special occasion, to me anyway, and particularly in Killarney. It's a great occasion, really. Undoubtedly, down the years, Kerry have been the major stumbling block, trying to get out of Munster. It's very hard to catch him on the hop, as they say.
That's knocked ahead by Jimmy Barry Murphy.
For a period in the early 1970s, Cork dominated Munster football, completely overpowering Kerry in the Munster finals of 1973 and 1974.
Cork were going to be good at senior level at that time, mainly because they had terrific minor teams. They were very successful at under 21 as well.
It's got a point.
I suppose if you look at the Kerry team, they were an ageing team at that stage, like they had been together for a long time.
One goal and 9 points for Cork and six for Kerry.
Things looked pretty bad in Kerry. And they found it hard enough to get a manager actually in 1975, and Gerald McKinney came to me anyway and he put pressure on and asked me to take over the team. So I had a look at what was happening around. I had been over at Old Trafford a few times and to see what type of training United and these were doing. Matt Busby was in charge over there at that time. When I came back then, I said, well, maybe it was time to change. Dublin had won the All-Ireland in 74, and they won it with a running game more than anything and a possession game.
He'd cast out, you know, pretty guys who weren't too old and brought on basically what was an under-21 team.
Everyone wanted to be on the team, and, you know, it was at least 20 good players there, all fighting to be in the first 15.
We were underdogs against Cork in the Munster final. I think it was Martin Doherty who was playing full-back. Left the ball slip through his hands, just an accident in the first couple of minutes. And I think it was that defining moment, that mistake, gave us the confidence and the momentum that we required.
And then all of a sudden Kerry's tails were up. Also it was the advent, I suppose, of a new era where fitness levels were concerned. The year prior to that, Kevin Heffernan had brought in with Dublin. Mick O'Dwyer's in his first year with Kerry, he picked up on it and he had a very, very fit young Kerry team, and we just couldn't catch them. They were too fast and too fit for us. They went on from strength to strength and like became, I suppose, one of the best teams that we've ever seen or would ever grace Gaelic football.
The city was looking east to Manchester United. You know, it was wanted soccer. It was really not sure what sort of sporting culture it could really embrace and call its own. Dublin gave it to them. And we had this situation where from a young Dublin team that had only won one All-Ireland were overwhelming favourites to beat Kerry in 1975 because Kerry were unknowns. And in the classic sense of the unknown contender coming out and scuppering the favourite, John Egan popped up and scored a goal and everything just fell apart for Dublin.
We came with a different brand of football, I suppose. We changed our game, we played possession football, but we had marvellous players as well who could kick scores from all angles.
It was a bit of a surreal experience, team of bachelors, no experience of big time football, but we went up there convinced by Dwyer, by Mico, that we were going to win. No fear, no inhibitions, no nothing.
There was always a kind of a feeling in Kerry that when we were going up to the capital and we were playing the Dubs in their own back garden, and that was an unfair advantage. But in actual fact, it was a great motivating factor for us.
I remember in the pep talk before the match, I told the lads we should be willing to die, literally die on the field for the victory. I remember getting the ball and taking on one or two guys and then seeing the gap, because had I got through the gap, there was nobody else there but Paddy Cullen. But unfortunately, I didn't get through the gap. I got knocked out, I got an elbow to the head, and I was unconscious. And I was unconscious for most of the evening until about 9 o'clock that night.
But he is KO'd.
We were the champions, and we certainly had a lot of confidence going into the game. It may be a factor that some people had too much confidence.
Nicely chipped up there by Mikey Sheehy and over the bar.
First time in an All-Ireland final, just out of minor ranks, just 19 years of age.
This is Pat Spillane. And they're giving it a point for Kerry. Young Pat Spillane He won't be 20 until the month of December.
Not alone you win in All-Ireland, but I end up accepting the cup through unfortunate circumstances because Mickey O'Sullivan got injured. That's the greatest honour that could be bestowed on any Gaelic footballer.
Does it give you as much pleasure, Mick, as the medal you won yourself?
Even more, I would say. Yes.
That under 21 team in 75 managed to do something which very rarely has happened in the entire history of Gaelic football, and that is catch 31 and a half counties, because including a lot of Kerry people, by surprise.
We all realised that we had disappointed ourselves, I suppose. And we made up our minds to realistically go at the 76 title in a very determined fashion, which we did. Any game for that period after 75 became very competitive, whether they were league matches or whether they were All-Ireland finals. Normally the team that made the first fatal mistake in the game wound up the loser, because things were very tight, there were very few mistakes being made, and normally the mistakes counted in the end of the day.
We were young, we were naive, and probably success winded ahead for a while. And I think Mick then decided that lads had to be brought down to size.
We were in demand, we were all bachelors, and we were all up for it. We were up for all kinds of antics and shenanigans at the time, and, you know, we paid the price the following year then.
76 we were deservedly beaten, 77 was on a kick of the ball between us. Could have gone either way up to a couple of minutes to go on.
At that time in 77, it was more or less the rubber game, if you like, because they had won in 75 and we'd won in 76. Sean Walsh. And both teams had improved significantly at that time.
And it's over the bar and they're level again.
That was a semi-final, but it was realistically the final. Now, it was a very intense game, and, you know, the lead switched every 5 minutes or so. And there was never much between the teams, and significantly Kerry went, I think they went 2 points ahead with 7 minutes to go. It looked like curtains for us, and then we reversed it around and we actually won the game by 5 points.
And Tony Hanahan has it now, in front of the goal, it's a goal!
77 was a fantastic semi-final, you know. I don't think we got a lost vision. It's just Dublin were a very good team.
Dublin versus Kerry became the subject of polite conversation in Dublin 4, which had never discussed Gaelic football before, became the subject of cartoons in the newspapers, and two evening papers fighting for circulation, Evening Press and Evening Herald, knew that they couldn't just write enough about it. Every time they mentioned Dublin Kerry, circulation went up.
After 77, within the county, there was a backlash. There were certain elements within the county gunning for Mick O'Dwyer. The chairman, Gerald McKenna, stood by him and reappointed him for 78. And the rest is history.
78 was to be the great fight to the death. This was the third time. Dublin were going to beat Kerry for the third time. And, you know, we could see the end of O'Dwyer, see the end of all that team of Pat Spillane and Ogie Moran and all of these great players.
'78 was a controversial final. Significantly, I think we'd won the league that year. Both teams were fairly confident. Things were very tight. We ran into an early lead. There were a number of incidents not involving Kerry. Kerry then wound up 2 points ahead at half time.
Paddy seemed to be in possession, and Gerard Powell came in and tackled him. And we were fortunate enough to get the free, and Paddy seemed to be arguing with the referee. And I just said, one look up, and the line was unguarded, so I had a go, and I was just lucky enough it went in, you know.
Well, Paddy Cullen wasn't the only incident. There were two incidents, and unfortunately, I think they probably had an upsetting effect on the Dublin team.
I think the start of it was Bobby Doyle was pulled up for overholding the ball, over-carrying the ball, which, if you look at the video, will prove to be not to be the case. However, at this stage, I don't want to open up that wound again, but there were incidents, and I just want to say they had nothing to do with Kerry, but there, in my opinion, there were some very bad decisions given that day, which had an adverse effect on our performance.
In that Kerry tradition, when the pressure comes on, they seem to go somewhere really strange and produce a classy footballer who turns the whole of the county and the whole of the country and the whole of Gaelic football on its head, and they found it on the beaches of Ballybunion.
And it's another goal! Another goal for all Lisbon! And Kerry are on the high bell!
Agus fáise do an óra go minis an cairn a bhronna ar dunacha ógaí mórna.
They were the greatest team I ever saw because they're the greatest set of natural footballers and natural athletes. And I mean, it doesn't matter what era they were in or what style of football has been played, they would have adapted. The big thing that made them really, really great was the arrival of Owen Liston. Having Liston there, no more than Kieran Donaghy, it provided an alternative. And boy, did they make use of that alternative. And, you know, he was the man, really, that made them great, really great.
Well, I suppose the better question is, what would have happened if the two teams were the same age? I think our team were more or less finished in 78. A third of the team were well over 30. 79 was our sixth final in a row, which I don't think had been achieved before or since.
The rivalry of Dublin and Kerry lived on, but the hurt that was caused in the capital in 1978 was never really overcome.
It's important to stress, you see, that Offaly had no inhibitions about playing Kerry, because I came in 76, 77, and it was only 5 years earlier that Offaly had beaten Kerry in an All-Ireland final replay. They're only the second team in history to beat them in a replay in the championship. Well, in 81, the big factor for us in that game was the first time we'd ever played Kerry in my team, the forwards got no goal. Remember, the year before, they had scored 4 goals and 15 points against us.
And now they're really,
we saw that as progress.
Egan across to the far.
It was only decided in the last 10 minutes when Jack O'Shea got a goal.
In it goes now, and a goal! And Kerry have done it! Kerry have won 4 All-Irelands in a row. They've won their 27th All-Ireland in all. And they truly are the kingdom of football.
After the 81 final, we were fairly certain that if we kept improving at the same rate, we would be in there with a great chance the following year. We actually really believed it. And of course, nobody else believed it, which was a great help.
In towards the goal mouth, Liam Connor.
The biggest problem for them was the pressure, psychological pressure of this, doing something that had never been done before in GAA, to win 5 All-Irelands in a row. And the public, of course, couldn't perceive of any other result, not just the Kerry public, the public of Ireland at large.
There was a real sense of, Offaly were going to come, mug their man, get their All-Ireland and go back, you know, retreat again, because that's all they needed to do to win their places in history.
But they're not out of the woods yet.
I specifically remember saying, we cannot beat Kerry in the first half. We can only beat them in the last 5 or 10 minutes, because if you were ahead of Kerry with 15 minutes to go by 4 or 5 points, they would definitely come back. They had the power to do that, and that would give them the motivation to come back.
Insurance once again.
The plan didn't work in so much as we went 5 behind, went into the last quarter, which was appeared to be too much with the rain dashing down and everything like that. But Kerry panicked a bit then, and a lot of the players went back into defence.
All of us, every one of us, became negative, started funneling back towards our own goal. Problem with that is that you invited the opposition towards it. They attacked in waves, got a few handy scores, got a few very handy frees.
Tommy Doyle picked up Seamus Darby, who was the sub. But Seamus Darby didn't line out right half forward, he lined out at left corner forward. On a strictly technical level, I think that was the most important part of that game, that Tommy Doyle switched inadvertently from his normal position to right fullback.
In towards the corner, nice shot, and a goal!
And the worst time to get to concede a goal is literally in the last kick of the game, because you have no time to recover. Believe me, if it happened midway through the second half, we'd have won the 5 in a row.
Winning the way they offered.
But Liam O'Connor surging out and getting the ball up and the crossing ball and the swivels and the turns and the kicks and the green flag going up and the 5 in a row shattered
The gift taken away is one of the great folkloric stories that crops up in every culture, and here we had it, and live on our television screens in 1982.
Kerry people, when the game looked sun up, left Croke Park to get the early trains home, and were not, came down on the trains, not knowing that Offaly had come back and beaten them.
One thing in sport, you like to go out on a high. We came back and we won three other All-Ireland titles, and the only reason we won those three All-Ireland titles was revenge for losing that 5 in a row.
The real achievement of 84 to 86 was coming back from the trauma.
84 to 86 was a bunch of newcomers and old fellas who were living on their reputation, but had enough form and enough experience to carry their way through. Tyrone should have taken us in 86, but I think just the sight of the Kerry jersey and the fear of Kerry, I don't think they had a belief that they could really, really beat us.
Two defenders, lovely balance.
We got a couple of handy All-Irelands in 84 to 86. Now can Owen
Liston finish off what has been a... During those 12 years, if there was one downside, there was no effort to bring in young players. Because the ethos was, why change a winning team?
That's a failing with all great managers and with all great players, I suppose. No one has ever come up with the magic formula of when to take the last hurrah.
It wasn't a question of I deciding that I would retire, I suppose. One likes to play forever if you can, and you just eventually get dropped, and you just fade away.
It began for the first time to be reflected upon that this predestination that they had mightn't be a predestination at all, that the Gaelic football party would continue every September, and Kerry, by divine right, were no longer going to be there anymore.
It coincided with several new teams winning All-Irelands as well at the same time, as Kerry would say, in our absence. Like Donegal won and Derry won, and then Tyrone and Armagh came later. So it was a very productive time for the GAA as a national organisation. But Kerry people would say that's because we weren't around, we didn't have a decent team.
The big threat to Kerry really was in the 90s, and I remember reading articles in the local papers, in the Kerryman and other papers, national papers, saying that soccer was going to take over. And it was being played an awful lot, but I think it's actually peaked in terms of its appeal. It's now played, a lot of people play both sports, but we have seen over the last 10 to 15 years that people will play both sports. There is room for soccer and rugby and other sports, but I think Kerry people will always have their first draw for Gaelic football.
The coming of Paddy O'Shea in the mid-90s as manager. He had the great experience of playing on that great team, start to finish from 75 to 86, winning 8 All-Irelands on the field of play. He came along, and of course, the man was almost possessed, you know, with managing a team that would win the All-Ireland.
I remember Paddy made a comment when he took over the Kerry senior team at the time, that he was going to put the spirituality back into Kerry football. Now, we at the time didn't know exactly what he meant, but he did. He started getting us playing for the jersey again, and we had that as a cliche, pride in the jersey and playing for the jersey. We didn't know what it meant, and Paddy just explained it, spelled it out in black and white, what pride in the jersey meant, what pride of place meant, what representing your parish, your club, your family, your friends meant. And I think we all bought into that ideology. That was one huge factor. As well as that, I think you had a lot of talent coming through in those years at the end of the famine.
Kerry fans have waited an inordinate length of time, 11 years, but the gap has been bridged. The famine, as they say, is at an end for Kerry. They celebrate, well they might.
There were very special players in that team. I mean, Morris Fitzgerald, who would be my own personal favourite, all-time favourite as a footballer, the best I've ever seen play.
He had seen many of the bad days, because he began in 1987, but he kept going in the tradition of Kerry football, that the good day would come. It eventually came in the All-Ireland final of 1997, and the man rose to it like the star he was, you know. The fantastic points he got, the one he kicked from the ground with the left from the Hogan Stand side of the field.
Well, that's a brilliant kick by a brilliant footballer.
Kerry followers, they're very demanding. they want success. Different people have expressed that in different ways.
The Kerry supporter is not interested in a five-year plan. There's only one yardstick in Kerry, the end of September, bottom line.
And Gaelic football supporters can be quite, you know, hard on their own team, especially hard, very often much more hard on their own team than on the opposition.
In a frank interview with the Sunday Independent, Paddy O'Shea spoke about the disappointment in the kingdom about Kerry's failure to deliver an All-Ireland title last year. Kerry people, he said, did not like to lose, adding that being the Kerry manager is probably the hardest job in the world, because Kerry people are the roughest type of effing animals you could ever deal with.
Possibly the words that were chosen, you know, would have been, you know, unfortunate at the time. I think Paddy himself would even admit that. But every player under Paddy in that particular year, where he made his famous comments and remarks about the Kerry supporters, knew exactly where he was coming from and knew exactly what he meant.
I thought it was a compliment to Kerry supporters that they were animals, because they bloody well wanted Kerry in Croke Park every year, and which I thought it was a compliment.
You know, when Paddy was removed from office, I suppose you could call it, in 2003, We were hurting, the county was hurting, pride was hurt, and nobody's pride was hurt more than Paddy's, to be quite honest. You know, what happened against Tyrone was a type of football that had come on board that, you know, we certainly hadn't seen. We had been beaten the previous year against Armagh, and the perception was that was an All-Ireland left behind. Paddy, the players, the county board, there was no winners in that one, and what it did do was put a huge amount of pressure on the new manager, Jack O'Connor, coming into it.
That has never, ever, ever changed my feelings about the Green and Gold and the Kerry supporters, and, you know, it has been my life, and I hope it will always be my life. And now the O'Shea's are still keeping the tradition of football going in the parish, in the village.
The Kerry County Board decided in the year 2003 to offer the managership of the Kerry team to Jack O'Connor. I think Jack showed great bravery in accepting it. He wasn't a known name like his predecessors, but he knew when he took it on that he would be judged on how many All-Irelands he won. He had to win one at least to be deemed a success.
The big thing was that I hadn't played it into county with Kerry or I hadn't an All-Ireland medal, so, you know, I suppose I was the first to break the mold there. But, you know, I didn't see that as a huge barrier, because at the end of the day, you know, that might hold sway in the beginning or carry a bit of weight in the beginning, but once you start coaching players, they're not wondering whether you have All-Ireland medals or whether you haven't. They're just wondering, you know, does this man know what he's about? Does he have an idea of how to coach a team and manage a team? And winning All-Ireland is what it's about. Not national leagues and not even once the championships, it's, you're defined by whether you win the All-Ireland or not.
Football is different in Kerry. No county plays football like Kerry. This was the image that built up all the time, and it was generally substantiated, because Kerry that time got to an awful lot of All-Ireland finals because of the old system. So therefore they were always in the public eye, and they always produced superstars to catch the imagination of the public.
Most counties will tell you to win All-Ireland is great, but to win All-Ireland and beat Kerry in the final is like winning two All-Irelands. And that's why the victories by Tyrone and Armagh meant so much to them. And good luck to them, and I think Kerry people were delighted for them.
Ulster was a very, very interesting example of, once again, Kerry being told, your game is too light, too frivolous, too much space involved, you know, too much running. You close players down, you use... A confined space rather than open space to win matches.
In many people's eyes was tackling Baldry and fouling, but, you know, they were getting away with it, and it was within, as far as they were concerned, within the rules. So, you know, obviously Kerry had to change a little bit to counteract that.
Gets the free, takes it quickly. Donaghy!
They have struggled to cope with that type of game, but in the last couple of years, I think you'd have to say they have come to grips with it, and they've done so in a way that mightn't appeal to traditionalists. They have adapted their own game, they played a short passing game, they're prepared to pack their defence if necessary.
All we've been doing is responding to trends in Gaelic football. We like to think that we set trends as well. And Kerry have responded, they've absorbed those blows, those shocks, and they've raised the bar.
A lot of people, myself included, wouldn't be mad about that, because we regard Kerry as the standard bearers of the traditional type of Gaelic football. But all traditions have to change and mutate, and that's what's happening in Kerry at the moment.
It's Darrell Shea who wins the kick out.
The craft was always there. Maybe they lost out because of the physical dimension. But over the past 3 years, they have upped the ante on the physical side of it as well. And they play a physical game as well as a scientific and skillful game. I think you need all three now.
Got back to cover the hole in front of the fullback.
The year 2006.
They need to do it more if they're to cut off.
They did win the National League. They didn't win the Munster Championship. They were beaten fairly by Cork. But then a brave decision by the selectors to place Kieran Donaghy at full forward.
Challenged there by Paul Galvin.
He knew what they expected of him. He was able to do it. And a simple thing like that turned the year around.
For a third in all, dropped in dangerously. Donaghy, as he did in Killarney, out jumping Bellew. Donaghy! Back of the net! In the 39th minute! Having set up goal after goal in Killarney!
You know, it was almost like a moment of defiance. You know, he turned around to the goalie as well, and I think he left the goalie know about it as well. But it was just a great moment because, you know, all the Kerry players took their chest out after that and really, really started playing.
I think anybody over 40, certainly over 50, would still regard Kerry as the standard bearers. There, that you measure yourself against Kerry football teams, whether it's minor, under 21 or senior. The younger generation, I wouldn't say the same, because they're not aware of any form of total domination by Kerry. They've seen Kerry lose all Ireland finals, you know, in recent years, which used to be a very, very rare event. Over the next 20 years, I think the image of Kerry football may change slightly, that people may regard them as maybe just another leading football county, but not a county that's going to intimidate and frighten everybody else they play. The ultimate accolade is still to win the All Ireland for Kerry. I can't see that ethic being diluted in the foreseeable future anyway.
We want the greatness of our mountains in our footballers. We want the beauty of our lakes in our footballers. Because for one fierce hard hour, or now 70 minutes, the 15 men or women that play for Kerry out in the field are the expression, the physical expression and manifestation of the soul of the county.